I think cultural competence is really important. The way you're used to communicating may not be the same as someone else's. Well, there's vocal hygiene practices that could apply to everyone. Anyone starting their own business sort of feels like, how do I really start my own business? Where do I go from here?
Sure. I've heard that you had some tips for us to communicate better in the workplace.
Creamers, welcome to Get Creamy, the segment where we interview cool people who do cool things, who are innovative, entrepreneurs, artists, anything that's really interesting. And we dive deep into their heads and we figure out what they're doing and how they did it. But today, we do have a very special segment of Get Creamy. We are interviewing my good friend, Daniel Lipman. Daniel Lipman has a speech pathology business. That's right, she teaches people how to speak better. She helps people who may not be comfortable speaking speak more comfortably. She works with schools, she works with corporate people who have to give presentations, and I hope that she will work with me and show you how to talk better too, because I know that I could use a little bit more enunciation in some of the words of my life. So without further ado, creamers, let's get creamy.
Danielle, how are you today?
Doing great, thank you.
Amazing. So tell me about what it is you do. What's a speech pathologist?
So, a speech pathologist is a professional who works with people across the lifespan from birth towards the end stages of life to improve communication and swallow function. So, if you were working with the pediatric population, you might be working with children who have developmental delays or who are born deaf or who have, disabilities. If you're working with adults, it might be someone who has a stroke and loses their ability to communicate effectively, or someone who has a traumatic brain injury or suffers from head and neck cancer. It's focused on communication, language, voice. Those are sort of the areas that speech pathologists specialize in.
Amazing. So how did you get into this profession, or what's your background?
So I'm a licensed certified speech pathologist. I initially became interested in this field. It's kind of sort of random. People say, "How did you know you wanted to do that?" I've never even heard about that. I volunteered at a camp for deaf children when I was in high school. And you can also specialize working with the deaf population if you're a speech pathologist. And at that particular camp, there was quite a few speech pathologists, and I became interested in what they were doing. And although I ultimately did not end up working with the deaf population, that's how I initially was exposed to the field.
And then I'm guessing you ended up and you went to college.
I did. I went to
Amazing.
NYU undergrad. I did my master's at Brooklyn College.
Amazing,
So, New York strong.
amazing, amazing. And where are you from originally?
I'm from New York as well.
Oh, wow. Where'd you grow up?
I grew up between Forest Hills, which is in Queens, and the Upper West Side.
I guess you would probably maybe feel a little bit of gratitude or a little bit of like humbling, sort of servicing your local community.
Absolutely.
So tell me, in doing research for this interview, because I knew that you were a speech pathologist and we've known each other for a while, but I didn't really know too much of what it is in this field of speech pathology. So tell me a little bit about vocal hygiene.
Okay, so vocal hygiene, if someone, well, there's vocal hygiene practices that could apply to everyone, and it's things that everyone should in fact be doing to protect their larynx, which is your voice box. If someone were to experience frequent laryngitis, a lot of sore throats, losing their voice, you would definitely need to go see an otolaryngologist, which is commonly known as an ear, nose, and throat doctor or an ENT. And they would put a camera and take a peek at your vocal cords, your larynx. And that's an important first step because if you did have concerns about your voice before you could even see a speech pathologist, you would need clearance from an ENT doctor. So the ENT doctor could say, "Hey, the vocal cords look red and inflamed. You need to improve practices of vocal hygiene," or sometimes, it could be polyps. I'm sure you've heard famous singers like Adele has had to cancel tour dates because of vocal polyps. And those kinds of things happen. Polyps.
What's a polyp?
It's basically like a callus on your vocal cords, although, you know, they could end up being precancerous or cancerous, so you need to get that checked out by a doctor.
Okay.
But sometimes they happen just from abuse and misuse, because every time you are speaking, your vocal cords are opening and closing. And if you're slamming them together, you might get some of these kinds of calluses or polyps or nodules. And it can also be impacted by other things like reflux. But back to your question, you asked about vocal hygiene. And, you know, just some general tips to keep in mind. I know a lot of your creamers are musicians. So, you know, making sure to stay hydrated is extremely important. Cheers.
Cheers.
You want to be sure that you're adequately hydrated, all your mucous membranes are moist. Making sure that you're not abusing and misusing your voice. So if you're constantly speaking in really loud environments and you have to raise your voice and almost yell, that's really detrimental to your vocal cords. So sometimes you'll end up, you know, after they've gotten ENT clearance, you might end up working with a bartender who constantly is asking people for their drink orders and there's a lot of ambient noise and music. Or teachers who constantly are using their voice throughout the day. They're maybe yelling at students. Mm-hmm. These types of professions lend themselves to this kind of vocal use and abuse. Similarly, musicians, singers, they might be straining to reach particular notes and maybe not doing it in the most efficient or safe way.
I read that smoking...
Absolutely. Smoking.
It irritates the vocal cords. Or tell me about what smoking does to your vocal cords.
Well, you know, if you're putting smoke near those mucous membranes, it irritates them. It can increase your risk of cancer. Similarly, alcohol, you know, excessive alcohol intake is very bad for your vocal cords.
Is that because it's drying?
It's drying. It's, you know, poisonous to some degree. And, you know, your larynx sits in an area that, you know, can be touched upon if you have reflux. When you have reflux, it rises up to your esophagus and sometimes it kind of spills up a little bit further. And that acidity causes damage to the vocal cords too. And things that increase reflux are alcohol, tobacco, you know, dietary habits, sleeping in a particular position, mints. There's like a lot of things that can negatively impact your digestion and ultimately result in reflux.
So your diet is clearly something that's important because of the acid reflux. And that, so the acid comes up from your stomach and like damages or like splatters on the vocal cords and can damage them.
Right. So it may only reach the esophageal level, but it can go up a little bit further and cause some kind of, you know, splash damage to your larynx.
If that does happen, or if you're feeling a little bit of reflux, is there something that you could kind of do for a quick fix to protect your vocal cords?
I think that if it's a problem you're chronically experiencing, you really should see an ear, nose, and throat doctor who can diagnose it and give you specific recommendations. But as far as, you know, diet, lifestyle, there are some general things that you can do. So obviously, if you're overeating and you're completely filling your stomach, the valve that closes it off from the esophagus is more likely to kind of open up. So you want to avoid eating like really heavy, big meals. Mm-hmm. You want to avoid lying down after you eat, because as you can imagine, if you fill your stomach with food and then you lay back, you're increasing the chances that you'll get reflux.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, you want to, you know, depending the position that you sleep in, it might be better to have your upper body a little more elevated so you're not completely flat, which, you know, gravity is kind of working against your favor. Things will come back up. You know, and the diet guidelines are comparable to a lot of like healthy eating guidelines. You know, very heavy food, very spicy food is another thing that can cause reflux. Some people experience it a lot when they have garlic. Other people experience it more if they have heavily seasoned food. So that's another thing to keep in mind. They've also found that menthol flavored products cause the sphincter to kind of open up, which can increase the occurrence of reflux. Seltzer or carbonated beverages. And you know, there's a whole...
I like seltzer water.
I like it too. And I think that anything in moderation is okay. But if you do have an issue with reflux and you drink 5 seltzers a day, then that may not align with your ultimate goals.
Okay. So I drink maybe 5 or 6 non-alcoholic seltzers a day. And, you know, I've never really been able to sing very well at all. No. I'm like no good. Like zero. But I've been trying. I've been trying to learn. I have an app on my cell phone and I practice as much as I can. 5 minutes a day, 10 minutes a day, 15 minutes a day. And then you were like, the sparkling water, the seltzer water, that could be giving me like trouble. So I got worried.
Yeah. The other thing too is some people silently reflux. So they don't experience any of the signs or symptoms of reflux or the traditional ones that people know as heartburn. Mm-hmm. Or sometimes it's called agita, particularly if you're in a heavily Italian area, like some places in New York.
Okay.
But you may be silently refluxing and you're not aware that in fact it's happening. But if you do have, you know, hoarseness, fatigue, frequent loss of voice, it is something that you really need to get checked out by an ENT, because they'll be able to tell you if they see, you know, edema or swelling of your vocal cords or irritation, redness, that in fact it could be being caused by reflux. Even if you say, but I don't have acid reflux, I don't get heartburn, it could still be happening without you knowing it.
Interesting. So tell me about your diet and your exercise routine.
So my diet, you know, I eat pretty healthy. I'm not vegetarian or vegan. I did in fact try those things in the past and they just didn't particularly work for me. And I really think that there's no one size fits all. Mm-hmm. You just have to really be in tune with your body and figure out what works for you. You know, if you eat something, how do you feel after that? Do you feel good? Do you feel energetic? Do you feel really tired? So for me, I've found that, you know, eating fruits, vegetables, real food, not processed foods, chicken, beef, pork, fish, you know, sustainably farmed or, you know, wild caught, all of those types of things I try to buy, you know, when I'm able to. Mm-hmm. Of course, sometimes we don't really have control about what we're eating, if we're eating out or if we're at a friend's house. But when eating at home, I try to be a little bit more careful about the products I select.
Yeah, that's what I like to do. You know, when I go out, I like to have a little bit of cream on top. And when I'm at home, I sort of leave the cream out.
Yeah. I don't blame you.
What about your exercise routine?
I try to keep active. I feel like sweating and exercise is really part of a daily practice for me, make me feel my best. I don't really feel great if I don't do something physical at least once a day. I mean, you know, there's always off days and rest days, but it can be a run in the park. It can be, you know, a 30-minute workout in my bedroom on like, you know, little kind of home gym area I created.
Do you use any of the new apps?
I don't actually use any apps. I am a huge fan of this instructor. Her name's Sarah Gilardi. She does a Pilates HIIT. Uh-huh. I used to physically go to her class on the Lower East Side at Fierce Grace Studio, and she kind of started her own thing called Action Team Fitness. Uh-huh. So I really enjoy her workouts. I love Taboo Fit from Instagram. He's great.
Yeah.
So I do things like that. I do my own thing, just something at least every day, a hike, a walk, a run.
You have a female-owned business. In starting your business, did you have to go over any hurdles? And if so, do you have any tips for other entrepreneurs, or do you have any stories of crushing it?
Speech pathology, in fact, is a female-dominated profession, you know, industry, career. So becoming a speech pathologist as a woman, I don't think had any particular challenges. If I had to speak to challenges of owning my own business, I think that maybe just the lack of, you know, encouragement or perhaps support or availability of information to get started may have been sort of an area of weakness or something that posed a challenge. Perhaps that's true for male entrepreneurs as well. Maybe anyone starting their own business sort of feels like, how do I really start my own business? Where do I go from here?
Sure.
So perhaps those challenges weren't particular to me being a female. But, you know, I've been fortunate enough to have the support of family, friends, mentors, you know, prior bosses. And so I felt able to do what I've been doing. And, you know, knock on wood, it's been successful for me and I thoroughly enjoy it.
Do you have any tips for over finding that knowledge that you felt was lacking now that you've overcome those obstacles?
Yeah, I think that, you know, if you have an idea and you think it's good or you have a skill, you shouldn't lose hope or faith in yourself. That information is out there. It seems scary or challenging or overwhelming, but, you know, you have the internet, you have a computer, you have friends maybe who have done it, family members, you know, get a taxpayer ID number, you know, get a name of a business, you make sure no one else has it. There's a whole process to go through. And I think that, you know, if you're determined, you can do it. People do it.
Yeah.
So just, I think you got to have determination and you have to believe in yourself.
Absolutely.
And I always encourage people, you know, why not? Do it.
I've heard that you had some tips for us to communicate better in the workplace.
Yes. So one of my areas of focus is I do accent reduction and corporate mm-hmm. speech training. So I'm typically working with non-native English speakers who may work in the medical field or finance, banking, and they feel as though their accent and or communication skills is negatively impacting their ability to move up at work.
Mm-hmm.
So one of the things that we train people on is how to improve their corporate speaking skills. So three tips that I would give for improving communication in the workplace. So I would say number one would be embracing the pause. You know, a lot of times people feel this time pressure to answer or to say something when in fact that time pressure really doesn't exist. If somebody asks you a question, particularly if it's a superior, you know, you don't have to answer right away. You can take a minute, think about what you want to say. And in some ways that might make your response look even more thoughtful. And it also just gives you time to formulate your thought. And typically, if you've taken a moment to formulate that thought, it's going to be communicated better.
Sure.
So that would be my first tip. Another tip I would say is using effective and efficient communication. A lot of times I find that people feel the need to provide extraneous information. They want to sort of maybe show their boss or a coworker how much they know about something. But really, there's no need. If someone asks you a particular question, you should answer that question. You don't need to provide all this extra information. So if I asked you, for example, you know, what's the next place you'd want to go on vacation to? And give me one reason why.
I want to go to Brazil because I've never been there. And actually, no, I don't want to go to Brazil. I want to go to Buenos Aires because when I watched the movie Starship Troopers when I was a kid, and that was the first movie that I saw a female naked in, I said to myself, I want to go to Buenos Aires and then get on board the rocket ship and go to Mars or wherever they go in the movie Starship Troopers.
So here we have two examples. Our friend here did not embrace the pause and initially said he wanted to he wanted to go to Brazil when in fact he wants to go to Buenos Aires. So had he taken a moment to formulate his thought, he would have been able to tell us that he in fact wanted to go to Buenos Aires from the get-go. And in addition, he provided all this extra information about spaceships and Mars when really that didn't pertain so much to the question. He could have just said, I really want to go to Buenos Aires. I'm really inspired to go there from a movie I saw as a kid. If I wanted to really know what movie that was, why it inspired him, I could ask that question as a follow-up. But that really wasn't what I was asking. I was just asking where he'd like to go and one reason why. So that highlights the importance of embracing the pause and using effective and efficient communication. The last tip I would give is probably, you know, I think cultural competence is really important. You know, workplaces are so diverse, especially in a place like New York. You know, it's such a melting pot of cultures and religious beliefs and people from all different kinds of places. And I think it's really important to understand that the way that we communicate or the way you're used to communicating may not be the same as someone else's. So things like proximity, you know, how close you get to someone when you talk to them, or gesturing or eye contact. You just want to be aware of who it is you're speaking to and be aware that cultural differences may come into play. So you want to try to be as respectful as possible and just be professional.
Do you have maybe like a bucket list of top cultural differences that maybe you see people are unaware of?
I would
And I mean,
say,
we're in New York, so this is a
right.
diverse place, you know, and sometimes maybe you come from a small town, or you come from a town in another country and you're not so aware. And it's hard to know all of the cultural differences
Yeah,
and to be aware of them.
you're right. And it would be impossible to know all of these cultural differences. And I don't think that you need to. I think as long as you acknowledge that cultural differences could be at play with regard to things like eye contact, like proximity, like body language, and you take that and keep that in mind when you're communicating with somebody, that way you won't take something personally or maybe think that somebody's, you know, being rude or not attending to you. I think if you address, hey, you know, that was kind of weird that they wouldn't look me in the eye. Was that disrespectful? Or you might instead say, that was a little different than what I'm used to, but maybe, you know, in this person's culture, maintaining eye contact is not something that they're comfortable with. And just leave it at that. I think it's just sort of making space for the cultural differences that can impact communication.
Ms. Lippman, Danielle, thank you for gracing us with your presence
My
and for
pleasure.
teaching us a little bit more about what a speech pathologist does and how to more effectively communicate with people who you work with so that you can be a boss and crush it. Tell them how they can follow you or find you if they think that they might need a little bit of help with
Their
their
communication.
communication.
They could find me at lippmanspeechservices.com.
That's it. So, if you are a CEO or you're a grad student looking to improve your voice, then, and you live in New York City, or now that we're on Zoom, you just want to Zoom, hit her up, find her. She's amazing. Thanks, guys.
Creamers, if you liked this episode, give us a thumbs up. If you hated it, give us a thumbs down. If you want to see more, then you better subscribe and hit the bell icon so you get notified after every episode we release. If you want to tell us what to do, leave a comment. And if you want to see us play Ding Dong Ditch in your neighborhood, follow us on Instagram.